stress. That means no script writing of language or whatever reading writing, but more emphasis on plays, games. And that is where entertainment industry and entertainment education will play a big role. In fact, it is not only freedom for you, but how you will explore your capabilities in order to empower our school children. I think that is where a very important thing, because we all know that there are several games, you know, students all enjoy games, actually, whether it is physical games or the computer games or whatever types of games. But how do you inculcate such games which will actually add value to the learning that is going to happen, you know, in terms of even creating values? You know, you can have some games where values can be also inculcated into the student. If you do this, there are positive points. If you do that, negative points, and you carry on a lot of situations and how do you react. And through such games, one can really emphasize on what gets you value for your life or what will not, actually. So entertainment industry, media industry has a role to play. You can design such games, and therefore this is all important. You are also talking about events in this program. I am remembering that different types of functions that are held in the colleges, you know, apart from the clubs that they have. The clubs is also an event. They continue to have annual programs, but there are certain annual features, you know, like sports festival or games festival. There can be also a festival for art. There will be a music festival. There can be even festival for your various types of technological events. And they go and collect funds from various industries and philanthropists, and then collect that money, account it. And the entire event management itself is also a big training for students while they are in the colleges. And that develops leadership and how we connect them with the sports. You know, sports, we talk about sportsmanship spirit. So I think that sportsmanship spirit coming to the event, whatever event they are doing, and you connect all of that, and whatever they are learning in mechanical engineering or electronics or physics or math or psychology subject, I think they all can be like connecting the dots. You know, so I think through that, the education will truly become holistic. And therefore, whether it is your own domain where it is required, or whether you will help other domains, I think there is a great value which has been emphasized in this education policy. And let us make this a win-win situation for everyone. These are my initial comments. And in future, when I listen to others, if required, I will also pitch in later. Or if there are any questions, I will again come back.
Yes, Anilji. In fact, what we are going to discuss today is that, you know, instead of putting it outside the curriculum and letting students do it on campus, how can they have event management as a subject in engineering? How can they have, you know, photography as a subject in engineering? At the same time, maybe animation. The same would go with, you know, even many of the art subjects, combination of science subjects in the multidisciplinary. That's how the industry requirements are. The next I'm actually going to go to is Dr. Chenraj. You know, sir, you have seen, you know, things which actually have been defined in the last 40 years by you, when you actually had students from the colleges, when you had affiliation with, you know, the state university. Then came, you invested into the schools. At the same time, then when the private university law was passed, you started with the private university, which is now deemed to be university. Having gone through this life cycle, sir, it's not only that you have followed the formats that existed, but we know that you have given more than 200 players to this country. You have given more than 27 players to IPL. You have given players to, you know, the Asiad Games and the Olympic Games, and you have created more than, you know, 5,000 to 6,000 entrepreneurs, because you are known for your you know, insights of creating entrepreneurs. How do you see the national education policy will be able to put this into the final formats that is going to emerge?
Thank you, Ashish ji, and thank you, sir. Anil Sasrabuddha, sir, I think he defined the national education policy in a very refined way. I will just put 9 points to it. Navratnas. So Navratnas, I will say inclusive, equitable, quality, sensitivity also is kept in mind, lifelong learning, flexibility, rootedness, synergy, and interdisciplinary. So these are the 9 wordings I get out of the Navratnas of a national education policy. In fact, I am thrilled because I thought I was always applying this unconsciously or subconsciously from 91 onwards when I started the institution with just one girl. She wanted to commit suicide, sir. Bibek Banerjee and Rajesh Binnewalaji and Sabha Josephji. She wanted to commit suicide and she was a daughter of a telephone engineer just behind my shop. And he came and told me that she did not get a seat in IIT, so she'll commit. I said, why? Why should she commit suicide? It is not IIT is not the end of the road. There can be BSc, there can be BCom, there can be other engineering colleges, there can be humanities. But you don't know, Chenraj, my job is central for 1,200 rupees salary as a telephone engineer. We South Indians only try to get impact in education. Then finally, I convinced that girl not to commit suicide. To her father, she did not meet me. Only for that girl, I started the college, sir. I was a part of Reliance Industries doing a business. I was at the age of 14, I took up a 40 rupees job. I took the school because it was only rote learning. So I was against that, not against education, but I was against that rote learning. There was no knowledge, there was no co-curricular, there was no encouragement. So in the school days, I was the only boy given 12 games to play. So even today at 59, I can do 800 push-ups like that, come on to training. So I saved that girl and she passed BSc. I started with BCom and BSc and only that girl passed, sir. So that was the turning point of my education. Except that girl, all the 34 students failed. All the 34 students failed and only that girl passed. Then she went to MCA. Sudha Murthy spotted her. She joined Infos. Then she joined Wipro. Then she got married. She had a husband. Her husband died on road accident. Today she's the best coder on the planet. She's the best coder on the planet in IT and an entrepreneur at 42-year-old. So that girl defined the whole educational philosophy for me that it is not about 98% marks, it is not about examination. I personally was a victim of the school study for 2 days, study for 15 days, write the exam and forget in 13 days. So there was no applied knowledge. So my whole idea was applied knowledge. So I brought into curriculum sports. So that is how this national education policy is now providing canvas of flexibility for you, which I was struggling to find that. But then I took a win-win situation. Let us follow the guidelines of AICT or UGC or the state universities, but nobody stops you after the college to give you a dual degree or sports or co-curricular activities, human networking, jungle trekkings and all those kinds of activities, going to the banks, going to the corporate, understanding what is an account. So Saturdays and Sundays, I used to allow the students to get into all these institutions and come with projects. So project-based learning, applied learning, and those who are interested in sports, arts, music, dance, theater, drama. I have the best Bharatanatyam dancers. I have the best musicians who are going to become Bhimsen Joshis of the future and Padma Subramanyams of Bharatanatyams. I have the best of the sportsmen. 8 people have gone to Olympics already. You would have heard about Rehan Puncha, Shikha Tandon, Aditi Ashok, Rohan Boppana, Anup Sridhar, Bharat Sharad Gaikwad, Gagan Ulalmak. They all represent Olympics who are just ordinary sports people. I said, no, don't come to the classes. My teachers will train you in 30 days. How to get and we'll give you attendance in the name of co-curricular. So we allowed them to, with all the club, and I started the institution in just 15,000 square feet building. And it was 24-hour shift. 3 ships I planned and I had no grounds, no building. I had no grounds and no sports facilities. But all the clubs of Bangalore and all the club grounds of Bangalore were my asset. So I used to go and take the membership and send students there. 1 month before my teachers used to train the students and they excelled in business, they excelled in sports, they excelled in arts, music, theater, drama. And I have created more than 7,000 entrepreneurs in my lifetime in this 30 years of my journey. And they're all doing well. And believe me, sir, these 7,000 people never knew the spelling of entrepreneurship. They were not from the family background. But we created that atmosphere in the college and that 30 years I have been following. I feel this NEP policy is made for me and now it is for the whole world now. So I thank Honorable Prime Minister and also Anil Sastrabuddha, sir, you also involved into this NEP policy. You also, your inputs were there. I think this policy is a landmark policy. Navratnas, I already told you, it is participatory governance. It is taking ownership and it is talking about governance, talking about classification, light, white, tight. So depending on the situation and leveraging opportunity. So everybody is inclusive growth now.
from an attender to teachers to trainers to thinkers, everybody plays a role. It is not a vice chancellor, or it is not a dean, or it is not a HOD. So for me, every person is divinely ordained. So I follow a philosophy of 3% entrepreneurs, 25% are knowledge force, maybe like Ashish Kulkarni, maybe Vivek Banerjee, maybe Sabha Joseph comes in the 3%. He's an entrepreneur. So 3% are the entrepreneurs, 25% are knowledge thinkers, like Vice President General, and more than 72% are skilled force. I followed this philosophy and I opened Opportunity School, 3,000 children, free education, and 800 children from family business in the schooling. I brought them, I charged them 5 lakh, 8 lakh rupees. And they subsidize these 300 children. So they will provide jobs to school, international school children who are from family business. These children will become skilled force and knowledge force. So it is the integration of three forces, 3% entrepreneurship, like Sabha Joseph sir, Bill Gates, or anybody who has become 90%, 75% of the wealth is held by the only 50 global business leaders. You can take Amazon has $200 billion is his personal net worth, and he's talking about $2 trillion value. So now the more than 80% of the people don't have access to even wealth properly. So this is the best way. The job providers, knowledge thinkers who add to the value of the and the skill force. This is a three model I followed in here, sir. And I'm very thrilled and overjoyed. People like you, IACT chairman, sir, who's a legend in the making. I have followed him very well. His thinking ability is a philosopher. This NAP policy will transform the whole philosophy of education and make better leaders and better thought leaders and better human beings, including spiritual quotient with philosophical quotient and with leadership quotient. I find all this mixed into the NAP policy, and there is no requirement of debating on that. It's just to put it into action and take it forward. Let us not say 15 years. 15 years is too much, sir. Only 5 years is enough. Why 15 years is required? Everything is available. Technology, digital, social media. Sitting here, I think 1 lakh people can listen to you. And from Harvard professor can train finance to all over the world, 5 lakh students. Now the professors are going to be the real thinkers. They are the knowledge force. They are entrepreneurs will provide jobs, moral support, economic development. So for me, I followed that philosophy. And with common sense, I applied, and today I have 2 lakh alumni across the globe, and I am going to create a million entrepreneurs and a million sportsmen and a million thinkers around the globe in the next 5 years to 10 years. I have worked hard for 30 years. Now NAP gives me the wings to connect with the whole 800 million population on the planet. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Chandra, sir. In fact, that's very inspiring. But I'm going to come to you as to where you have invested in the last few years. In fact, once I do the first round, I'm going to come to you on the sports university and also the design university that you have created. Going to Dr. Vivek Banerjee. Vivek, you have to unmute yourself, Vivek. When we actually discussed about the complete management, IIM Ahmedabad is considered to be either the top-notch institution, and you have also worked with many other greater institutions. When it comes to media and entertainment, the sports management, and even to that matter, event management, what stopped many of these designs where they have not considered such important industries? If I have to give you some examples, after the defense export, second largest export that happens out of US is media and entertainment. And media and entertainment export for some of the top 7 to 10 economies is amongst the top 10 or maybe top 5. Why is it that our management schools have not taken it in the past with NEP? How can we see this emerge into the management studies? And, if I have to hire a producer, which is a production management job, I have to hire an MBA who has never done production, never understood anything about it. Why is it that we have not thought it earlier? And what would it make, what will it take to make it happen after NEP?
Wow. Ashish, like a good academic, what I would do is I will get inspired by your question. And on occasions, I will exercise my liberty as an academic to sometimes sidestep it in order to maintain some sort of a propriety of the occasion. And I am known to talk very directly. And I want to put a disclaimer right up ahead in case I am sort of treading on somebody's feet. Kindly excuse me. You see, yes. So, listen, I think Dr. Chenraj had already laid the foundation for much of what I'm going to say, and which is about the fact that, the NEP is sort of like a recognition of a tidal change. Okay, it's a tectonic shift of a vision, which was like pre-NEP. You know, it's a vision that, you know, education has largely been the last bastion which has been held by government control, and the entire private sector has been seen as evil unless and until they prove otherwise. Okay, that, you know, they were all trying to sort of short circuit the they're going to sit there, make money by rent seeking, unless and until they do something otherwise. So what you have seen prior to the NEP age is there are some people, I mean, most of the serious and progressive universities who have, Dr. Sahasrabuddhe said that, we had all known the fallacy. We had all known the constraint set. And largely a lot of smart people in this and very educated people in this country had known what needed to have been done. But it really took a courageous government to actually bell the cat, okay? In the sense that coming out with a futuristic, forward-looking, liberal policy that allows for all of these things that both of my esteemed panelists from before have spoken about. See, there is a saying, Ashish, that you let the government run a desert, they will even find a way to make even sand scarce. So the education, which should be, I mean, think of it. Education should be, I'm saying intelligent education, free education, should be like the sand in a desert. It should be available to everybody. But if you look at our prior situation in this country, we have created this so-called, islands of excellence, much by, essentially the desert policy, like you just can't do it. And since you mentioned I am Ahmedabad, I used to wonder about, if you look at those, seats of excellence in our country that we call them, the IIMs, the IITs, etc., IISCs, there are so few of them that, millions of people are going after 200 or 300 seats. So the problem, if you look at the vision of the country's what we call quality education, was largely scripted on the basis of a model of scarcity. Now, what the NEP is recognizing, in my view, and I'm not directly addressing your issue, but the fact that, we need to look at education from the vantage of a plenty or an abundance, that every individual is a potential Chetan Bhagat. By the way, Chetan Bhagat happened to have been my student at IIM Ahmedabad. He went through IIT Delhi. He went through IIM Ahmedabad. He went and worked for, whichever multinational bank that I won't name. But eventually he found his calling in a creative vocation, which is directly linked to yours, Ashish, right? So I think let's not browbeat on why the country hadn't looked at this as a potential, right? So it is, in my view, a glass which is half filled with either water or more interesting fluid can be described in multiple ways, and the two of them is like it's either half full or half empty. Okay, I think this vision that every child, every human being can be an enterprise unto themselves. And the education, the world of education, starting from K-12 all the way to the higher education institutions, have suffered from this industrial, hierarchical, canonical, siloed, what do I call it? You know, it almost reminds me of those Charlie Chaplin's Modern Times. If you remember that first, I mean, the scene where he's, you know, humans are trained to just sort of tighten the bolts in an assembly line. And that's all that he does. And the guy goes nuts, right? So you know, the new education policy, as Dr. Sahasrabuddha mentioned, is a, for the first time in the domain of education to me, is a policy recognition that, you know, the bounds that policy has put in the unbounded nature of human potential, okay, has to be unshackled. And I can go on and on and on about, you know, if you look at most of the, you know, great case studies or examples that Dr. Chenraj gave at Shivnadar University, we have a policy of a sports scholarship. We are getting it in which, you know, Einstein had said, Ashish, that if you ask fishes to climb a tree, they wouldn't be so, they would look like such an idiot that you wouldn't even call them monkeys, right? So therefore, you know, when you have, you know, given that every human being is a potential, as I said, you know, and a university or an education system is the platform which should enable them to discover themselves, right? So therefore, whether it is media, entertainment, events, as we call it, design thinking today is one of the fundamental philosophies that is driving not just engineering or technical education, but, you know, management education, entrepreneurial education, that, you know, you may have the best car in the world, but if you don't have a design sense in trying to enable the conducive environment, if you don't understand the sociology of how people interact with each other, if you don't understand the psychology of how people are, you know, decoding and encoding and decoding messages, okay, they're going to take your Ferrari and the Lamborghinis and crash against the walls. So therefore, I think, I mean, just to finish, Ashish, I mean, I deliberately sort of sidestepped what was, you know, why hadn't they? Let's look at what is going to unfold going forward. What is going to unfold going forward, Ashish?
That was also part of my question. So
right. So it is, you know, like, I mean, forward-thinking institutions, I think they have already, you know, institutions like Shivnadar University, Ahmedabad University, ISB. I mean, you can name a lot of them that they have already been working on these philosophies of, you know, providing a platform for people to flexibly discover where their excellence lies. If it is badminton, if it is astronomy, if it is history, if it is performing arts, okay? And of course, you know, structurally, I would add one more thing that, you know, I think going forward, what you're going to see is the emergence of the new age universities. Because, you know, these islands of excellence under the technical education that, you know, Dr. Sahasrabuddha will probably agree with me, which were largely created with a certain vision that you want to put a specific focus on engineering or you want to put a specific focus on professional education. I think they have all, by the way, later on in the new avatars, they have all come out with schools of humanities, schools of business and commerce and so on. So willy-nilly, there is an acceptance that true education has got to be unbounded. Okay, of course, you need disciplinary depth and research in order to, and probably this you could take a segue into this, that you can't have multidisciplinary without being experts in at least one or a few of those disciplines. Yeah. You can't have a bunch of quacks, yeah. Right? I mean, you need expertise. You need research-driven expertise. You know, you can't, I mean, if you need a brain surgeon who's going to open up your brain to re-engineer it, he better be an expert in surgery, right? So you need that expertise. But at the same time, you need this integration that, I mean, I'm hoping that this new education policy is going to energize some things which a lot of the, you know, I think world-class forward-looking universities had already been, I would say, incubating or prototyping in their individual ways. And I'm delighted to see, you know, the government finally trying not to make sand scarce in a desert, but making every sand become a diamond.
Thanks so much, Vivek. In fact, I have to come back to you with a very particular question. But Rajeshji, you know, Vivek touched upon the issues of research. And, you know, it was said just last year that the people who are going to be teaching undergrads have to be master's degree, and the people who are teaching the master's degree have to be the PhDs. And in the media and entertainment events and the sports sector, and so to say, even in the design in the largely, we neither had undergrad programs, we had only diploma programs or certificate programs. You know, the research itself plays a very major role. So I want you to really touch upon, you know, for us, Subhash Ghai or Rajkumar Hirani is a PhD because they are an institution by themselves. When they teach, you know, nothing happens. But whether we are able to count that is one part of it. My second part of question is, you know, the social media emergence, the devices that are coming into, you know, the reckoning, the AR, VR, the mobile enhances, the platforms, is everything impacted by the media and entertainment technology? And today the consumption patterns are phenomenal. The whole population is affected with it. And so to say, because we don't have a say, or we don't have these faculties, so to say, within the present day universities and the present day school education for our verticals, all this research is also missing. And whether, you know, I want you to quickly touch upon how RFRF is going to play a role in building this, and how it will benefit the media and entertainment, sports and design verticals.
Yeah, thank you, Ashish. I would be liking to be very quick because we are already at 15:14. I'll start with the RFRF. Research for Resurgence Foundation is a platform which is focusing on higher education and research particularly. So whenever I'm looking at certain thing, I'm looking at with the aspects looking for the research. So everything which I look, even in EP, was the opportunities for research to be available and what can be drawn out of it. Research for Resurgence Foundation, with its 75 plus universities and then about 100 universities in connection from outside the country, are like collaboration is a mahamantra which we are dotting up for the making the research. And what we have started doing it is in academic institutions in India. Save for very few, which are exceptions to what I'm saying now, the research in the universities is really challenged. We don't have much of the facilities, we don't have much of the expertise and ideas, everywhere it is challenged. We thought of taking up this challenge as an opportunity and provide a solution to RFRF, so in that case, we will make this opportunity for the academicians, and particularly the academic institutions like universities, Indian universities. Now, fortunately in NEP, there is an NRF. This N and this NRF and RFRF is almost looking like same. And what we thought, and in fact, we have contributed to it, Anilji can vouch for his 2018, we have given some points to Ministry of Human Resources and Development that what should be the NEP including. And that is precisely the draft of NRF. Okay, so this NRF is the research opportunity created in the NEP. Now, in NEP, there are a few things which I would like to stress upon, and then coming back to the second part of your question on the social media, AR, VR. Few points which I would like to connect, to have a connectivity is, this flexibility which has been offered for the subjects is a tremendous opportunity given for transboundary education and transboundary research. Because this flexibility which was not there before, it was not possible for me to learn a music along with what chemical engineering I was doing. Okay. And unfortunately enough, I could not do anything in the music, and which I regret much right now. Okay. I might have tried to do something on tabla, but that doesn't make actually the formal thing. Secondly is, this particular NEP, this policy particular is saying somewhere that it is a learning centric, and rather we found it is more learner centric. It's not teaching centric, it's not learning centric, it is learner centric policy, because learner has got a more opportunities to learn what he wants to learn. And that is basically will put all his ambitions true, that he wants to come with what kind of line colors in what areas. So the learning centric is something which is very important. Learner centric is very important, which has come over here. And one more point, which was which I was always speaking in many forums, because I have been to Japan for my PhD, stayed over there, and my son went to some kindergarten school over there. And the schooling in Japan, and then I saw it in UK also, that early age is a personality development room. Early age childhood is personality development. And for our country, for Bharat, we are first time talking it officially in NEP. And this is very important, because the kind of foundation which you are going to have for your entire life, entire education, and then further down to the life is a personality. What you will carry is a personality. What we used to do in our home as a sanskar, now that has become a part of education also. So this is something which is fundamentally very good, that early child education, early age child education is nothing but the personality development. And coming back to now your virtual reality or augmented reality or kind of social media kind of thing. See, when I'm saying opportunity to be given to the early age children, now what happens is there are some certain environment which could be hostile, and you cannot really put those students over there to understand. Let's say firefighting is one of the very important thing to learn in the childhood, but you can't really subject it to the firefighting. And then you can't really subject certain hostile environment. One of the very good example I would like to quote here is there is a school in Kerala which has brought elephant right into the class using virtual reality. Now this elephant, which was there and moving around in the class, was actually not harmful because it was a virtual reality. But the students could see the elephant, which otherwise also in Kerala it is possible to see. What impressed to me is it can be bringing to the Maharashtra also, because Maharashtra seeing the elephant is not that so common. There was a solar system, sun appeared in the class, and around the sun's part, planets started moving one by one. This is something, if that could have been taught to me back in my school days, I would have not understood, I would have rather better understood the Big Bang theory and not got the zero marks on the Big Bang theory questions. That is something which I see and learn. That's what I'm saying, this will be more important. And virtual reality has taken a new shape now and new dimensions. My son graduated on 23rd of this August, and from IIT Bombay. And IIT Bombay has made a very good impact of making their convocation in the virtual reality. It was simply phenomenal. Some mismatches were there, but this is simply phenomenal. Ministry has to take a note of it on it. And the entire world started following this. This is the first time in the world this has happened. Now, first time in the world, something where it happened. But what I am trying to stress upon is all the social media is not only for making the opinions. It is also for providing certain educational facilities which are otherwise are missing in our area. So that flexibility which has been given to bring some people, say, for example, a physics guy can explain the whatever the planetary movement using the AR to the students. And this is already started. IISc Bangalore, we are working with one of the PhD students, and also one Karyakarta in Ahmedabad. So what we have started doing is bringing some virtual reality models to the village students, where they can't see certain things into the field, and they would not be exposed in that early age. So we want to bring back those experiments to them through virtual reality. And in environment, I'm not naming the state, but in one state with the National Environmental Engineering Research Institute, we are going to have virtual reality, augmented reality kind of courses on environment to understand the complexities of the environment and to do best practices in the environment, inculcate into right into the childhood. And of course, we are also talking about the higher educational institutions. So higher educational institutions also can be exposed to that. So initially, when Ashish ji told me about this multimedia and entertainment is the topic which is there here, what Ashish ji had a question, okay, why scientists should be here? I also had a question, what I will do over there? And then I realized I have too much to speak. I may not allow other panelists to speak at all. because I have been exposed to several things which are not there in my childhood, and now that has become the reality. It's not virtual reality, it will be sometimes a better reality. So social media also then again is not only for making the political opinions, it is also for certain things which are positive. And that social media, I'm not talking about just some chat and some, it's something beyond it. So Ashish, I'll stop here for the time being.
In fact, my thing is that, you know, it's, they are amazing examples that you gave. And we know the studios create this content. Even my studio create some of these content on the virtual reality and augmented reality. We now call it an extended reality because we mix the two as well. But it's called XR right now. But the challenge is that how do we bring it into the new fold of education and formalize it? My question to Anil sir is, sir, if you can unmute yourself. Every time that I went to the university, sir, in fact, in the last 25 years, I've been to more than 100 plus universities, requesting them to start the creative and performing arts programs and the design programs. Most of the time, the universities directed me to engineering. They thought animation, computer, you should actually do engineering. They made me sit with the dean of engineering. I kept telling them it's about artistic, it's about blending of technology, but more 80% art, 20% technology. And very few universities understood that to start with. My question to you, sir, is that, you know, the formats that we have and the evaluation or the assessment formats that we have in this country, it's about doing a written exam at the end of the semester. But if I have to formalize this as the NEP, would allow many universities to do creative arts, performing arts, design thinking, or even sports for that matter, or create an athlete from the school or university. The assessment cannot be done on the written exam. It will have to be done on the practical, because if I assess an actor or a singer or a director with a written exam, it's not a right way of assessing it. So what are your thoughts on, how this thing will roll out as the NEP rolls out?
Thank you, Ashish. In fact, Dr. Chandraj or Rajesh or Vivek, they have thrown light on all these aspects, but you are trying to, again, ask me the question because I sit as a regulator probably. but interestingly, I should tell you, and honestly, that AICT as a regulator started in 87, essentially for technical education. Technical included engineering, technology, along with that pharmacy, architecture, management, hotel management, and applied art, craft. We added design in the last year. So, but it is applied art, craft, and design. For whatever the reason, it was part of the AICT and assumed to be a technical education by the people who formed this act. The parliamentarians thought that, and therefore it was part of this. Having said this, in a lighter moment, unfortunately, another part is entire our education system, as we saw that, as rightly pointed out by Dr. Chandraj, etc., that the way we drove it all these 70 years was in one direction, and therefore our mental setup is also in that direction. And secondly, the chairman of the AICT, all previous chairman also, except the first 7 years when the HRD minister himself used to be the chairman of AICT, because when Act came in, they had to appoint, and since no one was appointed, it was assumed by the HRD minister himself. But subsequently, there is a academician. But all academicians have been engineers. Now, the philosophy with which engineers operate, they were equating the same for all other domains. This was the biggest mistake that AICT itself was doing. Art, craft, design requires a different type of a classroom environment. It is not just examination. We are talking about examination. I'm taking about the required facilities, the teaching learning process, and the examination. You see, all three are integrated, and therefore this was viewed exactly in the same way as that of engineering. So itna classroom chahiye, itna tutorial room chahiye, itna space laboratory chahiye. Oh, whatever is there for engineering was equated for pharmacy, for architecture, for management, for hotel management. Same is with the faculty. You don't have any PhD in hotel management, but you insist that to become a professor, you need a faculty with a PhD background. अरे यार वो जो अच्छा अच्छा नया नया चेफ बनाता है तो दैट इज इनोवेटिव एक्चुअली एंड पीपल एंजॉय दैट फूड ही शुड बी गिवन मोर वैल्यू देन व्हाट अ पीएचडी फेलो डज एक्चुअली सो आई थिंक दीज वर ऑल लॉपसाइडेड थिंग्स व्हिच कंटिन्यूड एंड इन द राइट पर्सपेक्टिव द एंटायर एग्जामिनेशन सिस्टम शुड बी मूव्ड अवे नॉट जस्ट इन योर डोमेन व्हिच यू आस्क फॉर मी इन द स्पोर्ट्स और इन द आर्ट और क्रिएटिव थिंग्स बट इवन इन इंजीनियरिंग और इवन इन आर्ट्स और कॉमर्स आई थिंक Written examination is only one type of examination.
Yeah.
The evaluation of a candidate, his understanding, whether he is able to know it and then apply it, can he analyze it, can he synthesize it, can he be creative and produce something completely out of the box. I think for this, you cannot have a standard 3-hour examination paper and make the student sit. And therefore, in some respect, some of the IITs, which they have innovated in terms of examination system also, whether it is open-ended examination, open book examination. You give a lot of time and every individual can have any amount of time that is at his disposal to go and search the... Because in the industry, no one is constraining you that from memory you have to produce it. You know, you work with teams, you take help from other people, then you go to the internet, you go to the books, you find out what is relevant and then bring it up. But why in education we restrict them that you have to memorize everything and reproduce it in that 3-hour examination? I think, therefore, what you rightly said is the examination should be of all variety. It could be some kind of quizzes. It can be Viva. It can be given a problem and let him go and solve it. Let him be sent to the village, find out what are the challenges, bring it to the board, and then try to solve it. And that's why our hackathons, which we have started for the last 4 years, have been an instant success. You know, all students enjoy that. And very interestingly, it's a 36-hour non-stop, non-sleeping format in which students will come with out-of-the-box solution and start coding and produce a solution. In a classroom, a teacher has to monitor so much that in 1 hour also, they are not attentive. Oh, no, you come here, don't go there, here, don't watch your mobile phone, a teacher says. And here for 36 hours without monitoring, they are working on their own. So that means where there is interest created, where there is challenge, where there is opportunity, our students also come off age. So I think that is where, as you rightly said, examination is different. You know, sportsman requires a different exam.
Yeah, I think that's the assessment part. I think if we are able to innovate on assessments, it's going to be really helpful for our verticals of, areas. In fact, we wanted to discuss a lot about the schooling part, but I have one particular question to Chenraj, sir. I have seen you have set up a huge, sports university with, starting with about 5 to 7 sports. You're going to do it about 52. You have set up a design school right now. There was always a question, skills were always considered a little lower than the education. But, if you have to have a livelihood and what I have seen with the JN students, you were always able to bring out skill much better than while they were getting educated for something else. What's your plan with the sports university? That's probably one of the first big effort for integrating 52 different sports and also the design university together. How do you really intend to do this? What are the kind of curriculums that you feel will emerge with the help of the new education policy?
30 years before only I emphasized on all-round holistic development. According to their perspective, they want to be a photographer, finance expert, something like CFA, CA, ACS. I always followed dual degree policy I followed. One, I followed the university rules, UGC rules. One, I followed dual degree. So college life was co-curricular activities. We used to give them attendance 75%. And 15 days before, they used to study and pass the examination with 80%, 90% mark. All my sports people, Anil Sastrabuddha, sir, are above 85% and 90%, including Pankaj Advani, 7 times world champion. Including Rohan Bopanna, including Robin Uthappa, including KL Rahul, including Mayank Agrawal, including Varun Arun, the fast bowler of the Indian Test cricket team and one-day player. So we have produced more than 6,000 sports people in last year at local level, state level, national level. Not only sports people, like 6,000 blocks you will find in all fields. We have done it.
So I 15 years before, when I gave them compulsory that a student needs to somehow get an opportunity for 2 hours of sporting that develop their physical development, motor movement, cognitive and mental development, social development, encouraging healthy active lifestyle, nurturing sportsmanship spirit, team building, integration, assisting students in their own physical and potential endurance. So these are the thoughts which I always believe that emotionally, socially, they get bonded. So they develop a leadership quality. Either they become a job seeker or a job provider. And only 3% are job providers, like visionaries like Sabha Joseph or what I mentioned earlier also. So my whole idea was that now I cannot start an IIM or I cannot start a Stanford University or Harvard. Now Harvard University student also is a failure. It is not about the degrees. It is not about PhD. It is about passion. It is about lives. It is about what you enjoy doing. Now you yourself mentioned, sir, that in hackathon 36 hours without policing, they're able to bring the best out of that. But in the classroom, we do it. I never allowed my students to stay in the classroom at all. Even today, Jain University, 98% of the time, the students are outside doing same theoretical activities through action and in action implementation. So one-third theory, one-third practicals, one-third action. So in that, values also come, teamwork also comes. I create a 5 students group. I bring 2 teachers. I bring 2 industrialists, some general manager or HR. 10 people will create a project. By the time they complete, then they have completed 36 projects in the 36 subjects they wanted. Your engineering is 182. But this same girl who wanted to commit suicide came to my college. 30 days she trained 25 people, and all 25 people got a job of 40 lakh rupees in Japanese companies outside India and some other companies in the coding area. 40 lakh rupees salary, the students cannot speak proper English also, but they learned that particular skill. So it is, I have allowed everybody to follow their path because the parents followed the peer pressure of parents. Father says, I didn't become engineer, you become engineer. I didn't do commerce, so you do commerce. I said, whatever parents say, don't package them, they're God. You come here, I will give you all the opportunities to enjoy water. So you fulfill the parents' dream of passing a degree, but you fulfill your passion. Like the 3 Idiots movie. So do this and do this also. And so I created a school 15 years. I started a sports university, a sports school for the children who can play 8 hours of sports and only 3 hours of studies, flexible studies. So they develop all-round personalities. And 52 games I'm going to launch because since we already have 6,000 sportsmen, this is India's first sports school. I invested 200 crores rupees on sports facilities 25 years before. And in 250 acres, I have stadiums, I have Olympic swimming pools, national swimming competition was done on the Olympic parameters. Athletic sports, football grounds, even the best Australian cricket ground is ours, is a better cricket ground. And that kind of facilities we created for the students. And today we have 350 children from the school. And the best of the junior level players, we have given them scholarship. And they are going to be the Olympians. They are going to be the national champions. I assure you, sir, in 15 years, I give you 25 to 40 Olympic gold medals in all the sports personally from this platform. Rest all corporates will do. HCL also will do. Shiv Nadar, sir, also will do. Yes, Azim also will do. But I have already given proof of concept without money. I started with 40,000 rupees in my pocket, sir. I didn't have any money. I didn't have any school education. But I have 2 doctorates, honorary doctorates given by our own Indian universities. Just because I work. But I particularly, I believe in entrepreneurial thinking, teamwork, work in a company, 5 days do a job, Monday to Friday, Saturday, Sunday do entrepreneurship, dual income, dual degree, and dual verticals. I have sports as a physical fitness, mental wellness, bring Ayurveda life into it, and compassion, philosophy. Human, and we are the only university in the country where we run human networking academy, where we teach the main management and human values, 100 marks paper. Yoga, transactional analysis, public speaking. In Toastmasters, I have got 6, the world's highest body in the world, having Toastmasters membership for students who become public speakers. And more than 400 students are earning 5 crores rupees a year. They don't need a job. They need to get into event management. So Sabha Joseph, I have collaborated with Sabha Joseph, and they're going to create 5,000 entrepreneurs. And we create a design school. They have put the interior design. One girl in the design school, she has come out with 500 designs of the world bedroom design. And she's already got 25 crores rupees of work order. 10% commission, she'll get 2.5 crores. And she's just passed out from an interior school in a design. This is where I think Ashish inspired me. So I brought design element into it, arts element, humanities element into it, event management element into it, for a sports element. So a person has to have an all-round development. And I have a proof of 30 years with me, more than 40,000 case studies. So that is an university for me. I don't need to get into the labeling of Harvard or Stanford or just because I'm Harvard Business or legal. I think anybody can become a world-class citizen, provided he enjoys what he likes to do. This is what I am doing, sir. But at the same time,
absolutely.
Absolutely, sir. In fact, before we end, I have one quick question for Bibek Banerjee. Bibek, you have brought in a large amount of collaborations. I think quick short words on how the collaborations are going to help our universities and the education system. Mostly the collaborations have come in the universities. Do you see these collaborations from overseas coming in the schools also?
Oh, by all means. I mean, I think most of my panelists have mentioned willy-nilly that, we don't do large things individually. I mean, any good things, even if it's a finished product is an Olympic gold medalist. Whether it's a Rohan Bopanna or a PV Sindhu. It's a product of a collaboration, right? So we all... understand that we all work in our specialized domains, but if we don't figure out a way to bring the critical resources and the critical visions together, good things don't happen, right? So I think collaborations is in the center of it all. By way of sort of democratizing collaboration, I mean, once again, I am extremely hopeful what previously used to be a very orthodox kind of like a university collaborates with a university. Today, I mean, of course, in the technical education, like in IITs and IIMs or in management, we know that since the reason people come here is for a professional education and they are seeking an outcome. So willy-nilly collaborations happened with the industry, right? But largely it has been for job-related issues. So Ashish, as you know, as I said very controversially early, I have made no bones in saying that a lot of our management and technical institutions, in the absence of good research, are nothing but placement agencies, really, right? And which I think it is going to change going forward. So collaboration is at the heart of it. I mean, who you collaborate with. And as I was saying that, of course, it's so refreshing to hear Dr. Chenraj and his vision about enabling. I was just thinking, listening to him that, when you're building, whether you want to build a sports university or a music university, only, as he said, like probably less than 3 or 2% of their graduates are going to go win Olympic medals and become professional sports people. But the whole idea is that the philosophy or the, the education that sports or music or performing arts media, entertainment, events is a huge space. That itself has a value. They have a value that contributes into that design thinking, right? So in that point of view, I would expect, collaborations. In Shivnatha University, we already have collaborations with not only universities, but also industry bodies. We have collaboration with FICCI also. We have collaborations with sports bodies, with conservation bodies. And as I was alluding to before, that, and I'm going to touch upon something that I was itching to talk about, examinations, for instance. Professor Sahasrabuddha would know that in the credit-based system, it's a CBC, right? So you have every courses would have their individual assessment mechanism, while some of the courses may be okay to do, like a exam-based assessment. But a lot of courses are about the outcome-based assessment. So if you are going to be an entrepreneur, go into a simulator or if you are going to be a stockbroker, go into a financial simulator and show me how much money. I'll give you some imaginary money. You play in the market, in the simulator, and you show me how much money you make. So more the money you make, better the grade you get. Similarly, if you are training to be a ballet dancer, right? The culmination of your training or your education needs to be a performance. I mean, you know, like go to the world and give, you know, like in design, people have portfolios, right? So create your thing. So translate theory into actual practice. So in all of this, collaboration is at the centerpiece, Ashish, and I would expect that, much in the spirit of the new education policy, which comes as a breath of fresh air, I think collaborations would also transcend, boundaries of orthodoxy and ke bhai, hum toh sirf isi ke saath kaam karte hai. The other thing that I must mention over here is the role of technology. Let me tell you, with the advent of artificial intelligence and, machine learning, IoTization of content as well in media, you would understand that you see the shelf life of knowledge has shrunk enormously. Okay, gone are the days where you could get away teaching material that you did 20 years ago, 10 years ago. Today, if your university is still peddling material too, which is like as old as 6 months ago, you may have already been complete obsolete. So how do you stay on the on the boundaries of what is not just knowledge, but how knowledge is getting translated into actual products, actual designs, actual movements, right? And therefore, I don't see how universities can survive if they're constantly doing these publication-based, professors shut themselves in their offices for 5 years and come out with 3 published papers that only 7 people other than them understand in the world. I mean, that's also important for the scholarship, but that's not enough. So I think collaborations would be a key to success.
Yeah, so in fact, while NEP is just kind of getting unfolded, we at media and entertainment design, as well as events and sports industry, are very delighted with every single aspect of the national education policy. And we are, really looking forward to collaborate with several schools, even at the rural areas, because we believe in our industry, the best talent comes from the rural areas. How do you create that ecosystem in the schools there? And how do you really see work in terms of even collaborations between universities, to do joint research in our space? And, the complete Research for Resurgence Foundation and the National Research Foundation initiative, we need to really see how our industry, which is always thought in the education process, left out, wants to become inclusive in the whole process. And we look at these inclusions happen with new patterns of assessment, new patterns of designing curriculums, new patterns of, letting people interact with the industry and the industry collaboration for research, may it be finding indigenous solutions for public sector or for the governance at large or for the private universities or private industries. I think all these opportunities are open. We have some of the biggest products that have been built, like the IFA Awards, like the IPL. And there's not enough research on how IFA has impacted the world and created the Indian image of cinema and entertainment. And how many people traveled to those countries after IFA happened in those countries. So those countries have benefited. But how do we actually leverage that into creating India as a bigger hub of export of media and entertainment is something that a matter of research and management. And I believe that, we have surpassed 15 minutes. But I would like to personally thank each one of you for finding out your time and giving your insights. It's, we have recorded this. We are going to look at it again and again. We are going to come back to you at every level to push our agenda, because we as industry would like to collaborate with academia in the right way to make sure that we build world-class creative hub out of India. And even in terms of sporting and media and entertainment technology and devices and the content creation, because there's a digital content economy that is happening all over the world. And if we miss out our bus by not putting our content onto that platform, it's going to be a big loss for India. And I think this is the biggest opportunity. We need to convert that into a big success. And that's why we would like to make sure that we collaborate. Sabas has been waiting for us for coming in. I think as the events industry, which is lead managed by him, there is an association called IMA, where Sabas was the president. And now we are collaborating with several universities. I also would like to suggest Sabas that IMA and Wizcraft also signs up with RFRF to push that agenda and look at research, because I was surprised to know that the events industry is bigger than the film industry. But we just don't have the research, and that's why we don't know it, how to position it.
We've had a fantastic session. Thank you, Dr. Kinrad. Thank you, Dr. Bibe. It's challenged our mind, challenged our thinking, and it has given us new thoughts and inspiration for the way forward. Each of you have been inspiring, and that, I must say, is a huge thing in today's day and time. And the National Education Policy has been welcomed by each of you as if it has been made to order for each of you. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time, and thank you for your dedication. God bless.
Thank you, Anil, sir.